Well, today we are going to discuss the Prakriti, the Ayurvedic constitution as explained in Ayurvedic textbooks, and also the recent advances in this field and the current research practices that are going on. We'll try to understand what is Prakriti first, and then we'll continue with the current understanding of Prakriti. Fundamentally, no two individuals are exactly similar, not even twins. So each individual is different. And we often classify people based on some common attributes, such as date of birth, maybe sun signs, or race, caste, gender, religion, economic class, region, and so on. So many types of classification of human beings are already existing. We are already using these classifications. But how does Ayurveda do it? How Ayurveda does this classification? So Ayurveda does this based on physical features, behavioral patterns, of course, along with psychological features and physiological features. So these are the domains based on which Ayurveda classifies human beings. So physical features might include the shade of skin or the hair, muscularity, body frame, etc. Whereas psychological features might include the preferences and choices for certain foodstuffs or the kind of reaction one shows in a particular situation, or mental abilities, memory, behavioral patterns, and so on. And physiological features include maybe the frequency of eating, bowel movements, the intensity of hunger, depth and quality of sleep, intolerance to heat and cold, and so on. So these are certain parameters that Ayurveda considers for classifying human beings into different categories. And Ayurveda calls it Prakriti. We call it Prakriti. Prakriti is nothing but the sum total of physical, physiological, and psychological traits expressed in an individual. And according to the principles of Ayurveda, doshas determine one's Prakriti. And as we know, there are three doshas, Vata, Pitta, and Kapha, and their dominance determines the Prakriti in an individual. Dosha is a term that indicates fundamental mutually reciprocal mechanisms responsible for maintaining the homeostasis and thus health. And when the state of equilibrium is disturbed, the result is often ill health and disease. This is the meaning of dosha. And the three doshas, they have been ascribed with specific functions in the body. For instance, Vata is initiator, it is the motive force, it is the major controlling mechanism, it is responsible for divisions, it is responsible for sensory perceptions, it is also responsible for movements. So these are certain important functions of Vata. Pitta performs the functions such as production of heat, energy, digestion, metabolism. And Kapha performs the functions like giving strength, resistance, protection, immunity, and also growth. So Ayurveda proposes that a specific attribute of a dosha has a causal relationship with the specific trait expressed in an individual. So each dosha has got some specific attributes. For example, Pitta is Ushna. Ushna is heat. And this particular attribute in the body leads to enhanced digestive and metabolic activities. Similarly, Kapha is Shita, it is cold. And this particular attribute leads to the sluggishness in digestive and metabolic activities. Vata is Chala, or mobile, or mobility is the feature of Vata. And this makes an individual more active. Kapha is Sthimita in nature, that is rigid. And this makes the individual less active. So, based on these attributes of a particular dosha, these individual traits in a person are manifested. This is a table that shows the different attributes of particular dosha, and as you can see, there are some opposite attributes and there are some equal attributes as well. So these are some equal and opposite kind of mechanisms, Vata, Pitta and Kapha. For instance, Vata is dry, whereas Kapha is Nigdha, unctuous. Vata is Laghu, Kapha is Guru. Vata is Shita, Pitta is Ushna, but Kapha is also Shita. So Shita Guna is similar or common to Vata and Kapha, whereas for Pitta it is the opposite. Similarly here, the Parusha, roughness, is there for Vata, but the opposite is there with Kapha, smooth. Vishada, non-sliminess, is opposite to that of Vijala. Chala is opposite to that of Stimita. Similarly, Drava and Sandra are opposite. Drava is the feature of Pitta, whereas Sandra is of that of Kapha. Sharp, Tikshna is the attribute of Pitta, whereas dull, the opposite one, is the feature of Kapha. Similarly, there are some individual attributes which are unique to each dosha. So this is very important to understand before we start discussing on Prakriti. So in general, this is how we can summarize the features of an individual with Vata Prakriti. So if the dominant dosha is Vata in an individual, then these will be certain important features. Of course, there will be some other minor, less important features, but these are very easy to be captured in a clinical setup. For example, lean and thin body frame, a typical feature of Vata. Usually Vata people are not obese, usually. Unstable with respect to hunger, bowel movements, sleep and determination. Again, this is because of Chala Guna of Vata. Chala is indicative of movement and instability. So these people with Vata Prakriti are unstable with respect to their hunger. So their hunger keeps varying. Sometimes they get good hunger, sometimes their hunger is very, very low. Even bowel movement, sometimes they are very regular, sometimes they are constipated. Sleep is also unstable. Most of the times they don't get good sound sleep. The sleep pattern is usually disturbed. Determination is also unstable. They are unstable with respect to determination. Mostly they are timid in most of the situations. Similarly, quickness is again another feature of Vata, and this leads to the traits such as quick to get started. If you assign any task to Vata person, then he or she will immediately start. He will be the person who would start that task very quickly. They will be fast and quick to grasp the things. But at the same time, they are also quick to forget, and they are also quick to catch illnesses and diseases. So these are the effects of quickness, that is the feature of Vata. Cold intolerance again is a very common feature that is seen among Vata individuals. Their skin and hair are mostly rough and dry, again a typical feature. Then unstable bonding with people, again another feature of Vata Prakriti. Coming to Pitta Prakriti, people with Pitta Prakriti have got very strong hunger and very good digestive abilities because of the Tikshna and Ushna Guna of Pitta. They also have very good analytical skills. Pitta Prakriti people, they have got good analytical skills because Pitta is responsible for transformation or analysis. They also have leadership qualities. They develop early baldness and graying. They easily get irritable and sometimes they are short-tempered. So this is again because of the sharpness of Pitta and Ushna Guna of Pitta. They have often got numerous moles, freckles, pigmented patches in the body because of the coloring ability of Pitta. Pitta is the dosha that gives color to most of the structures in the body. Intense body odor is again another feature of pitta. This is because of another attribute of pitta, that is to have a bad smell. And then heat intolerance, because already pitta is ushna. These people with ushna dominant personalities with the will have heat intolerance as a very important trait. Then is kapha. Kapha people usually have a strong muscular body. They have usually got an attractive physique and also attractive voice. Their skin is oily. They have thick and shiny hair. They are also slow and stable with respect to starting any task, eating habits, working out, performing exercises, to catch diseases, to grasp, to forget, and to maintain body postures. For example, kapha is more related with the resistance power and immunity. So they have got good immunity, and they usually are not susceptible to catch diseases. They are slow to grasp, but once they grasp, they don't forget, because they are also slow to forget, right? So also they do not keep changing their body postures. They usually are stable. They have got this again cold intolerance, and they are not irritable at all. They are very calm and composed, and they are also have a strong bonding and relationships with people. So these are some very specific traits that can be observed in Vata Pitta and Kapha Prakriti individuals. So the prakriti of an individual is determined by the dominance of one, two or three doshas expressed in that individual. So mostly we never have the dominance of single dosha. Mostly we are all a mixed people, right? So though it is determined genetically, several environmental factors too contribute in its manifestation. Prakriti is determined genetically, but environmental factors also they contribute in its manifestation. Especially in Charaka Samhita, the role of environmental factors has been specifically elaboratively it has been mentioned. Sushruta has mostly focused on Shukra Shovanita Sanyoge Yo Bhavet Dosha Utkataha Prakritir Jayate Tena. So he has mostly placed emphasis on genetic basis or inheritance, whereas Charaka, while explaining Prakriti, has discussed the factors which are other than genetic factors, like environmental factors. For example, Matura Ahara Vihara Prakriti, Kala Garbhashaya Prakriti, and so on. The Charaka's explanation of Prakriti is more complete. And therefore, on the basis of one, two, or three dominant doshas expressed in an individual, one can have any one of the seven possible types of prakriti: vata, pitta, kapha, vata pitta, pitta kapha, vata kapha, and finally samadoshacha. So these are the types of prakriti that are possible. So there could be seven categories of people based on prakriti according to Ayurveda. In the recent years, the individualized approach to therapeutics has received impetus with the growing understandings in the field of genetics. Many workers have investigated the possible association of constitutional types with the genetic makeup, metabolic abilities, and chronic diseases. And there have been several efforts to see whether certain physiological or biochemical tools can be used to establish a link between constitutional types and other health related parameters. So these are certain recent developments that are taking place in the context of prakriti. Well, coming to the assessment of the prakriti of an individual, how to assess the prakriti? So prakriti is a state of normalcy. So that a particular prakriti, though there is some dominance of one or two doshas, it is normal for that particular individual. So it is within the normal limits. We are assessing whatever is within the normal limits. There are quite a few difficulties that are encountered in determining one's prakriti. The age, physical and psychological features or status of an individual, presence and absence of any illnesses and seasonal influences are the major factors that tend to distort the outcome of the prakriti determination exercise. For instance, elderly people are likely to exhibit dominant features of vata because of dry and wrinkled skin. These features of vata are likely to be exhibited dominantly in extreme winter as well. Right? So this is how the seasonal dominance or the age can mislead a doctor while assessing the prakriti of an individual. A depressed overeating individual is likely to present with dominant features of kapha. Because of depression, a person could come across as a kapha prakriti individual. Differences in the subjective perceptions of the physicians also can make the assessment ambiguous, resulting in high inter-rater variability. The absence of definite recommendation for identifying one's constitution to be either due to a single dosha or due to two doshas is another problem. So there are no set guidelines whether a person's prakriti has to be identified with single dosha or dvandvaja, because almost always there are more than one doshas that contribute in an individual. Also, there is no data available to show the dominance of a particular type of prakriti in a given population. No such studies are available. The standardized, validated and universally acceptable tools to assess prakriti also are not available, and this makes the situation even more difficult. Of course, there are a few good tools that are available to assess prakriti. This is one of them. We have designed it and it has been validated and tested for its reliability to a reasonable level. It is published in a good journal, but the problem with this tool is that it is self-reporting tool. So you have to hand this over to the patient and or person, and then the person will report. So there are possibilities that the person may not report it properly, or the doctor might assess some traits more easily than the patient himself. So there are certain problems with self-assessment kind of prakriti questionnaires. CDAC came out with a very good tool called Prakriti Vichaya in IOSoft software, and that has been used quite widely, and there are several papers that have been published based on this IOSoft Prakriti Assessment tool. And recently, Central Council for Research in Ayurvedic Sciences has come up with a Ayur Prakriti web portal. And this is a tool that has been standardized, and it is available. Then Ayur Genomics, again IGIP group of researchers, they have developed their own tool to identify prakriti. So there are multiple tools available, and people use different tools for their research work, and that is the problem with the generalizability of the results of these research findings. So we need to resolve this issue of multiple tools, and finally we need to one day come out with a single tool that would become universally acceptable. Now coming to the recent research, genome-wide analysis correlates Ayurveda Prakriti. Whole genome expression and biochemical correlates of extreme constitutional types defined in Ayurveda. This also has shown that there is some considerable correlation between whole genome expression and the individual Prakriti. Then EGLN1 involvement in high altitude adaptation revealed through genetic analysis of extreme constitutional types defined in Ayurveda. Traditional medicine to modern pharmacogenomics, Ayurveda prakriti type, and CYP2C19 gene polymorphism associated with metabolic variability. Again, this is the paper that suggests the correlation between metabolic variability and this genetic polymorphism. Again, this was one of the early papers in this domain, HLA gene polymorphism and the concept of prakriti in Ayurveda. We have come out with a recent paper where we have suggested some good reporting practices for prakriti-based research. This is the paper that we have authored, and we have outlined the problems that are there with the assessment of prakriti and how one should report the papers or research findings based on prakriti, and what are the minimum expected descriptions that should be there in such papers. So like textual references, validation details, assessment of characters, scoring pattern, weightage assessment, and final expression of prakriti type, how was it done, and finally the full prakriti determination tool. So this is what is expected out of a good paper that is based on prakriti based research. So with this, we will conclude this talk. Thank you.